We have some data from this survey and from other sources on why people turn to complementary and alternative medicine. One thing that's very consistent whenever this has been looked at is that alternative use, use instead of mainstream health practice, is actually quite rare. One investigator who looked at that is Bill Lassiter, who uses databases that have been collected because of the coverage mandated in the state of Washington. And he looked at what patients are billing for who have a diagnosis of breast cancer. And very few people, a tiny number, who had a diagnosis of breast cancer and had bills submitted for complementary and alternative medicine. Essentially, all of the people who in that category also had bills submitted for conventional care. So we think that true alternative use instead of conventional health care is quite rare. There's data consistent with that from several of the surveys, particularly David Eisenberg's survey. The mix of reasons that people cite for use of these health practices is mixed between health and well-being and treating specific health conditions. And this is the data on specific health conditions. Back pain and neck pain in every single survey have come out as the commonest reason why people turn to these practices. And other pain conditions, joint pain, arthritis, headache. So this, I think, reflects the reality that that pain conditions, particularly back pain, is in fact very hard for conventional medicine to manage, and people turn to other sources for solutions. I don't show the 2002 data here, but there were some changes that are interesting in the pattern of use. In the 2002 survey, colds was number three after neck pain. And it fell as a reason people selected CAM by about half between 2002 and 2007. Some of that, we think, may have been precipitated by studies NCAM published showing that echinacea was not an efficacious treatment for colds, since that was the commonest herbal remedy used for colds. I'll tell you a little more about that. So NCAM has invested very heavily in research on herbal medicines. And part of that investment has been in large phase three type trials for some of the most common dietary supplements. This list shows the commonest set of supplements in the 2002 survey. I want to take a minute to tell you what we've learned so far about some of them. Echinacea was studied by two large studies looking at both prevention of and prevention of colds and amelioration of cold symptoms. And both studies failed to document any benefit of echinacea. And I think they were very well-performed studies. They have still left some lingering uncertainties, however. Echinacea has been widely studied in Europe, and there are, in fact, a reasonable body of positive studies coming from both England and Germany. And one of the lingering uncertainties has involved the preparation of echinacea and whether, in fact, it was optimized for bioavailability and so on. So there's still a small question mark, but using a well-characterized preparation, no benefit was found. The next agent that we've invested in on this list heavily, we have some basic work on ginseng, but not a lot of large studies. But we just finished, our investigators just completed, a very large study on ginkgo biloba for treatment of cognitive decline or early Alzheimer's. And that there two major papers came out of that. The latest was published in JAMA 3 weeks ago. And this was a large study, 3,000 patients, half on ginkgo, half on placebo, followed for 5 to 7 years with very careful cognitive function testing. And no difference was detected between the groups. The tiniest difference actually went against the active agent, although it didn't achieve significance. There was also no difference in side effects. there's been concern that ginkgo causes increased bleeding tendency. That did not show up in this study. There was no difference in the rate of bleeding episodes. I consider this a very clear and well-done study, and I think we're very proud of it. The data set that has been acquired will be publicly available to people interested in Alzheimer's research. It's the largest prevention trial of ginkgo ever, of Alzheimer's for cognitive decline ever done, and so it represents an incredibly rich data set. But the hoped-for benefit of ginkgo was not found. We have work on garlic has mostly been smaller studies. On glucosamine, this is the one area where the results, in fact, have been quite equivocal. There were two large studies done on glucosamine for osteoarthritis of the knee, one a functional study and pain study, and the other a study using imaging methods to assess the knee cartilage. Neither achieved clear evidence of benefit, although there were some hints in subgroups, and everyone at the School of Public Health, I'm sure, is aware of the hazards of drawing conclusions from subgroups. But so we still consider glucosamine as something that might help. The effects, if there are any, seem to be modest. Next is St. John's Wort. St. John's Wort is widely used for depression, and early in NCAM's life, actually, they completed a study on St. John's Wort for major depression, which failed to document effects. One problem in that study was that the effect of Prozac, the active comparator, was also minimal, as we're increasingly learning. Treatment of depression and antidepressives have a much more modest effect than I think some of us originally thought. St. John's Wort is also an example where the more with the benefit of the retrospectoscope, you really wish we'd known more about how it might work. It does look like St. John's Wort, some of the components of St. John's Wort, particularly a chemical called hyperforin, may have an SSRI-like effect, a Prozac-like effect. But the product that was used in this study was standardized for another component of St. John's Wort, hyperacin. And so with the benefit of that knowledge, again, there's still a big question mark. And finally, I wanted to mention fish oil and omega-3s. We and other parts of the NIH have invested fairly heavily in fish oil and omega-3 research. And this is actually an area where a number of positive findings have materialized. It is clear that omega-3s have a positive effect on triglycerides and certainly seem to be overall beneficial on cardiovascular risk factors, and at least in some of the systematic reviews seem to have at least inferential evidence for effects on harder outcomes like cardiovascular events and mortality.